During World War II, the United States invested in a research and development project, which they dubbed Manhattan Project. For this purpose, they founded a laboratory, the Los Alamos National Laboratory. It was a short distance northwest of Santa Fe, New Mexico, in the southwestern United States. The laboratory was founded during World War II as a secret, centralized facility to coordinate the scientific research of the Manhattan Project. The main purpose of the Manhattan Project was to develop the first nuclear weapons. General Leslie Groves wanted a central laboratory at an isolated location for safety and to keep the scientists away from the populace. During the Manhattan Project, Los Alamos hosted thousands of employees, including many Nobel Prize-winning scientists. The location was a total secret. Its only mailing address was a post office box, number 1663 in Santa Fe. Though its contract with the University of California was initially intended to be temporary, the relationship was maintained long after the war. And it was in the summer of 1950 at Los Alamos Laboratory in New Mexico, right after World War II, that scientist Enrico Fermi and his co-workers Konopinski, Teller, and York had a casual conversation about UFOs that was destined to become one of the most famous conversations in the history of science. Join us in this video to get to know more about Fermi's paradox and its possible solutions. In one version of the conversation, Fermi, Teller, Konopinski, and York were having casual chatting during lunchtime. The men were discussing a spate of recent UFO reports while walking to lunch. Konopinski remembered mentioning a magazine cartoon which showed aliens stealing New York City trash cans. And as he wrote years later, more amusing was Fermi's comment that it was a very reasonable theory, since it accounted for two separate phenomena. Teller remembered Fermi asking him, "Edward, what do you think? How probable is it that within the next 10 years, we shall have clear evidence of a material object moving faster than light?" Teller said, 10 to 6. "One in a million," Fermi said. "This is much too low. The probability is more like 10%, which Teller wrote in 1984 was the well-known figure for a Fermi miracle. At lunch, Fermi suddenly exclaimed, "Where are they?" Teller's remembrance. Or, "Don't you ever wonder where everybody is?" York's remembrance. Or, "But where is everybody?" Konopinski's remembrance. Teller wrote, "The result of his question was general laughter because of the strange fact that in spite of Fermi's question coming from the clear blue, everybody around the table seemed to understand at once that he was talking about extraterrestrial life." York wrote, "Somehow, we all knew he meant extraterrestrials." However, Emil Konopinski was not emphatic that he immediately knew Fermi was referring to possible aliens, merely writing, "It was his way of putting it that drew laughs from us." Fermi died of cancer in 1954. However, in letters to the three surviving men decades later in 1984, Dr. Eric Jones of Los Alamos was able to partially put the original conversation back together. He informed each of the men that he wished to include a reasonably accurate version or composite in the written proceedings he was putting together for a previously held conference entitled Interstellar Migration and the Human Experience. Nowadays, a bunch of people don't know the conversation's details, but I'm pretty sure that you have already heard of Fermi's question at least once in your life. Where is everybody? Are we alone in the universe? Will we ever find someone to share our existence? Or are we just poor livings floating alone in the universe around a common star? The fact is that when it comes to answering these questions, one may get the creeps. Think about it. There are only two chances. One, we are alone. Two, we are not alone. Can you tell which is the scariest one? I mean, the second is scary because if we are not alone, then somewhere in the universe there exists another form of life that while we are minding our own stuff, it's minding its own stuff. I mean, don't you think it's weird to imagine that someone else, maybe a thousand light years away from us, on another planet similar to Earth, could possibly be doing the laundry at this very moment? And if it is so, are they looking for us? Are they trying to communicate with us? And why is it that we cannot receive their messages? Maybe we spoke different languages. Maybe they are intentionally avoiding us. And if they are avoiding us, why? All of this is scary, but what if we are alone? I think it would be much scarier. I mean, if we are alone, does it mean we are special in some ways? or it's just we are random livings created by a casual perturbation of the laws of nature. Isn't it weird? Either we are alone or not. The Fermi paradox has the beauty of the weird, scary questions that we are not ready to answer. In fact, after 70 years, it is still a matter of debate. Why? Well, the fact is that there are an estimated 200 to 400 billion stars in the Milky Way, and much more in the entire observable universe. Even if intelligent life occurs on only a small, minuscule percentage of planets around these stars, there might still be a huge number of extant civilizations. This, of course, assumes the mediocrity principle, by which Earth is not a special planet, but a very special one, a pretty common one. So why is intelligent life a rarity? Over the years, there came up some possible solutions. For example, 1. Extraterrestrial life is rare or non-existent. 2. Extraterrestrial intelligence is rare or non-existent. 3. Intelligent alien species haven't developed advanced technologies. 4. The nature of intelligent life is to destroy itself. This would implicate that we are going to destroy ourselves too. Anyway, this video wasn't made to get too much into the Fermi paradox. We're just going to discuss one of the latest possible solutions. If you want to know more about the Fermi paradox, you can watch our previous video about the Fermi paradox. As we were saying, we want to discuss one of the solutions that came up to explain the Fermi paradox. A few months ago, an interesting paper came out that essentially used statistical analysis to estimate the number of potential civilizations out there in the galaxy, but did so using several major assumptions. In fact, the only thing one can do when it comes to trying to give an answer to the unsolved Fermi paradox is to make assumptions. The biggest assumption, actually, was something that might be very helpful. All civilizations have a tendency to eventually self-destruct or self-annihilate. I know, here we go, another creepy thing. It could be because of some sort of dramatic climactic change, because of some sort of dramatic cataclysmic event that destroys the planet, or because the civilization reaches the point where it basically destroys itself. As someone has already theorized, the advances in technology could lead to our destruction. Also, some sort of crazy artificial intelligence, for some unknown reason, could end life as we know it on Earth. But yes, the assumption is that we will annihilate ourselves. In other words, the main premise here is that all civilizations have the same end. We just don't really know when and how long it takes. Based on this premise of self-annihilation, the scientists tried to calculate how many possibilities we have for having civilizations out there right now. Also, they tried to calculate when the best time was for civilizations to exist in the galaxy, and where exactly we would be the most likely to find more civilizations. Some other assumptions that had to be made in this study include, of course, the idea of prevalence of Earth-like planets around Sun-like stars. In this case, G-type stars. Another thing we could ask ourselves is, what are the chances for a civilization to be caught by a sort of really cataclysmic and potentially deadly events, such as supernova happening nearby? Also, a question to be answered is the probability and also the time required for civilization to develop just enough to be able to produce radio emissions and communication. In fact, we are able to detect only these types of signals. Every other type of signal would pass undetected, because we are just not able to detect them. But there had to be a numerical value for the tendency of all civilizations to eventually destroy themselves, even if the conditions are absolutely perfect. And so this is kind of similar to the concept we have here on the planet in regards to empires. All empires eventually fall. This sentence pretty much sums up all these assumptions. Now, because of all these assumptions, this is still a very hypothetical approach. But scientists found that the most likely place to find the most civilizations, even right now, is actually somewhere in between planet Earth, or between the solar system and the center of the galaxy. That region, about 13,000 light-years away from the center, has the highest probability of having the most Earth-like planets with G-type stars, according to these scientists, but possibly not currently. Scientists believe that this was very likely the case about 5 billion years ago. As you can see, we are not so lucky. In other words, 8 billion years after the creation of the universe, or possibly about a few hundred million years before Earth and the Sun were created, that's when the particular region in between Earth and the center had the highest number of galactic civilizations, capable of interstellar communication, and possibly even know of each other's existence. But with the universe now being 5 billion years older, and with us being on the outskirts of the galaxy, that's when the chance of finding another civilization becomes much, much lower. According to the scientists here, we're basically like a frontier civilization, and we also sort of arrived at the party kind of late. In other words, a lot of civilizations that might have existed have long perished, with the highest numbers still being clustered around the same area, around 13,000 light years away from the center, or about 12,000 light years away towards the center, towards this region. It is about 12,000 light years away from us, and it will be almost impossible for either one of the civilizations to know we exist, or for us to know they still exist. And also, if they do exist, they're probably just really young, or might not even exist yet. So in other words, even though the chance for their existence is higher in the middle of the galaxy, some of them might not have advanced enough to be able to communicate with us. We can conclude this discussion by saying that maybe at the party of the universe, where a bunch of alien civilizations were invited, we weren't. Maybe our civilization is just too young, and we cannot attend the party. And so there are other civilizations currently living in our universe. We are home with our parents watching Peppa Pig, while our bigger brothers that joined the first Woodstock have already died. Maybe there will be time for us to give a huge galactic party someday, when we will be adults. But it will take a little time. We just have to patiently wait and enjoy the ride. But we mustn't forget to start dreaming and preparing for our Tomorrowland.